This is very exciting. We have an almost standing room only crowd. Steve is pleased. Welcome to the fall meeting of the Chevy Chase Historical Society. My name is Angela Lancaster, and I am president of this organization. Before I turn the program over to Mary Sheehan, chair of the program committee, who will introduce our speaker, although he doesn't need introductions, I've got a few announcements. We are joined today by Mary Ferranti, our new director of the Archives and Research Center, and Colleen Newhart, our new graduate intern. And they're over at that table. Would everybody please give them a welcome? We're also happy to have Gail Sansbury here, our prior director, who was very instrumental in helping our speaker with his book. Thank you, Gail. I want to acknowledge the board of the Chevy Chase Historical Society. We all have these name tags so you can recognize us. Come ask us about the Historical Society. We can tell you, you know, what about our collection, and we'd love to meet you. We have three new board members since our spring meetings, Kate Sheckles, Virginia Crispin, and Alyssa Leonard. So we welcome you to the board, ladies. And we say goodbye to our board member, Alex Weiner, who is moving to Park City, Utah. What a life. Last spring, we said goodbye to Carol Coffin, whose board term expired after serving on the Historical Society board for almost as many years as we have been an organization. But we have some unfinished business with Carol. So Carol, could you come forward, please? Carol started with the Historical Society as a gala chair in 1986, and she joined the board shortly afterwards. Carol was never idle with the Historical Society. She was a gala chair in 1991 and in 1998. Most of the time on the board, she served as chair of the MAP committee and was responsible for collecting and preserving many of the hundreds of maps and architectural drawings we have in our collection. She was also co-chair of the Capital Campaign in the 2001-2003, which allowed us to move the archives to the Chevy Chase Library. And Carol served on the nominating committee for many years. Carol's steady hand, even temper, and excellent judgment has helped CCHS grow into the strong organization we are today. I'm delighted to be able to present Carol with a Lifetime Achievement Award for her 29 years on the CCHS Board of Directors. We're completing our 35th anniversary year, and we're excited about our next 35 years. So on your chairs, you should have new membership brochures. If your chair doesn't have one because it was a late chair getting set up, we have some extra brochures there. And I do hope everyone will take a brochure and consider becoming a member for 2017. We've got a good, strong organization, and we have terrific programs. There's also an evaluation sheet on your chair, or most of the chairs, again, not all. So please fill that out and help us to continue bringing you excellent programming. Please remember to silence your phones. There will be a time for questions and answers afterwards. And now I'd like to introduce Mary Sheehan, who's chair of the program committee, to introduce our lecturer. Thank you.
So hello, everyone. Welcome once again. Our speaker today, Steve Roberts, has both a name and a voice that is very familiar to many of us. Those of us who are fans of the Diane Rehm Show on NPR every morning hear his voice as a regular guest host, often filling in for Diane when she is away. Today, Steve will talk about his new book, Bethesda and Chevy Chase, which is part of the Images of America series published by Arcadia Publishing. While he was doing his research for this book, we were happy to welcome him to the CCHS Archive and Research Center on a number of occasions. We were pleased to assist him with his research, and we are proud of the fact that his book features a significant number of photographs and much historical information that he obtained from our collection. Steve has been a journalist for more than 50 years, covering many of the major events of the past half century. After graduating from Harvard in 1964, he joined the staff of the New York Times. His 25 years at the Times included stints as a congressional and White House correspondent, as well as bureau chief in Los Angeles and Athens. He then spent 7 years as a senior writer at U.S. News, specializing in national politics and foreign policy. Steve and his wife, journalist Cokie Roberts, write an award-winning, nationally syndicated newspaper column. In 2000, they teamed up to publish a book titled From This Day Forward, an account of their own marriage, as well as a look at other notable marriages in American history. The book spent 7 weeks on the New York Times bestseller list. He's written 2 subsequent books, a childhood memoir titled My Father's Houses, that was published in 2005, and From Every End of This Earth, the story of 13 immigrant families in America, that was published in 2009. Closer to home, Steve writes a bi-monthly column for Bethesda Magazine titled Hometown. He's an ardent baseball fan, and he also reviews sports books for the Washington Post. In addition to all of this, Steve has been a professor at George Washington University for 25 years, where he teaches journalism and political communication. He is a sought-after lecturer on American politics and the role of the news media. He has won a variety of awards for both journalism and teaching. Steve is particularly well qualified to write about our community's history, since he and Cokie have lived in Bethesda for 40 years and raised their 2 daughters here. In his spare time, Steve plays tennis and coaches his grandson's Little League baseball team. So please join me in welcoming Steve Roberts.
Well, really, I'm absolutely delighted to be here and see such a wonderful crowd. Couple of corrections. I have a son and a daughter, and I'm making that correction because the son is here. So we have to be very careful about that. It's also true that, Mary said, I could not have done this book without the enormous help from the Chevy Chase Historical Society, and they couldn't have been more helpful. And I recommend to all of you to go to the website, and you will see these exhibits, these online exhibits that they have done. That were, it wasn't just the photographs, but it was the narrative histories that they really very well done that I borrowed heavily from. I also want to thank particularly Gail Sansbury, who was a marvelous help to me. Among other things, introduced me to Harold Silver, who's sitting next to her. Harold is a wonderful collector of memorabilia in this area, and is specialized, actually, in postcards from the era of the early days of Chevy Chase, and several of Harold's works that he was very gracious to give me are part of the slideshow. I also want to mention that while Cokie and I have lived here for 40 years, 39 years to be precise, her family moved to this area moved to the house we live in Bethesda in 1952, but they came to this area. What was the year your folks moved to Stevenson Place?
Before I was born.
Yeah, so... I won't tell you when that was, but it was before she was born. We actually got married in the garden of the house we now live in on Bradley Boulevard 50 years ago, 2 months ago, or 1 month ago. So I guess this sort of qualifies me at this point as having some modest authority to talk about this neighborhood. I'm also particularly grateful for the chance to have an entire afternoon that's a Trump-free zone. And like many of you, I've OD'd on that. And what a pleasure and relief to talk about the history of Chevy Chase. It really was this, not only Cokie's family's long history here that got me interested in this subject, her girlhood church, Blessed Sacrament, right there on Chevy Chase Circle. Many of you know, a very important institution in her family's history. A few years ago, Steve Hall, the editor of Bethesda Magazine, was nice enough to ask me to start writing a column for Bethesda Magazine. And that also drew me more and more into thinking about the history of this area. And I want to start by telling you that no, Chevy Chase was not named for a Saturday Night Live actor. It might have been, but it was not. And actually, the history of Chevy Chase really starts in 1725, the modern history, when a man named Colonel Joseph Belt was given a land grant from the English king for 560 acres in this area. And Chevy Chase comes from, the name comes from Scotland, really. And the word chase in Scotland was a hunting ground. And he named this area Chevy Chase because there was a favorite hunting ground of his in the Cheviot Hills on the border of England and Scotland. And that's where the name actually comes from. So sorry about Saturday Night Live, but that actually is where it originated. And of course, in this area, as you can well imagine, this was all originally farmland. There are two main farms that form the area that's now Chevy Chase. This is a place called, rather odd name, Clean Drinking. Now that was sort of the farmland west of Connecticut Avenue. East of Connecticut Avenue. As you go out Connecticut Avenue, to the east of Connecticut Avenue, the farm was originally called Clean Drinking. Now, one of the reason why it had this rather odd name was because of a particularly notable spring that was on this property. And this area was known for its fresh water. And one legend has it, in fact, that a young George Washington, on his way back from a failed campaign, having fought the Indians in the Fort Duquesne in the 1750s, on his way back to Washington, legend has it, actually stopped here because the water was so renowned as a fresh spring. And that's where the name of that particular farm comes from. And this photo from the Chevy Chase collection is of the original farmhouse. And now, there's nothing left of Clean Drinking today in terms of buildings, but this house was very noticeable, and it was the homestead of a family named Jones. And yes, Jones Mill Road and Jones Bridge Road, both named for this family that originally owned Clean Drinking. Why don't you go to the next slide? And this is a photo of a party on the veranda at Clean Drinking. And Jones family in the earlier days were well known for being very hospitable. However, eventually, the last Jones to live in this house was a recluse named Nick Jones. He was known as a very strange character. In fact, one of the memoirists who, writing about the time, remembers that her mother would pack up a lunch for this guy and occasionally bring it over to him because he was such an antisocial and difficult person. And eventually the Jones property got divided. One of the became part of what's now the Chevy Chase area. The other farm that was part of the historical antecedent of this community we now live in had an even stranger name than Clean Drinking. This was called No Gain Farm. There are a lot of theories about the name No Gain Farm. Some people said it was just such bad land that they couldn't grow very much on it. But there's another legend that the McCubbin family, which originally started No Gain Farm, that there was in the early days, surveying was a little imprecise. And he had thought he had bought a certain number of acres. And when they actually surveyed it, he was short about 5 acres. from what he thought he had bought. And some people think that that's where the word no gain came from. But this is a picture of the, again, of the original farmhouse at No Gain. But this one, as opposed to clean drinking, this one is still there in a very, in a much more modern version. This is the modern version of No Gain Farm. It's right there on Brookville Road. And in fact, it's the same property where La Ferme, the restaurant that many of you know, this is right next to it. And in fact, at one point, No Gain was owned by a redoubtable woman named Minnie Brooke, who some of you know. And Minnie Brooke was a great suffragette, among other things, and also a very, not only great feminist, but also a great businesswoman and entrepreneur. And one of her businesses was postcards. And she commissioned some of the best postcards and visual images we have of early Chevy Chase, which Harold, as I mentioned, is the world's leading collector of. And she would sell them at this. She had a little tea house and a store right where La Ferme is. And many of the best photos we have from this era come from Minnie Brooke. And this is obviously a much more modern version of No Gain, but it's still there. You can go see it. And another thing you can see on this property, right off Brookville Road, is an old cabin, a stone cabin, that is still preserved. I have a picture of it in the book. I don't think we have a picture of it today. But one of the important things to remember about the farms of this area is that they were virtually all owned slaves. And this is a history of Maryland that a lot of people don't know about, because everybody says, well, this is not the Confederacy. The Confederacy was on the other side of the river. But the fact is, virtually every farm in what's now Bethesda and Chevy Chase did in fact have slaves. Not necessarily a lot, but some. And we're pretty sure that this small stone cabin, which is still there on this property behind this house, was at one time a slave cabin. People don't realize that Maryland, while not only was a slave-holding state, even though it was part of the Union, but that Abraham Lincoln got about 2% of the vote in Maryland. That's my only political reference of the day. But in fact, during the Civil War, there were a lot of Confederate sympathizers throughout this area. In fact, there are legends of Confederate troops when they came down through Rockville to assault the Capitol during the Civil War. There were young women from a boarding school in Rockville rushed out to greet the Confederate troops because they were such sympathizers with the Confederacy. There are very few records left, very few buildings left that about the slave-owning history of this area. But one of them that I recommended to you is the Josiah Henson House. Some of you may know, right off Old Georgetown Road, there is a farmhouse with a small outbuilding attached, which is universally known actually as Uncle Tom's Cabin. And there's some dispute about this, Josiah Henson was a slave who escaped, went to Canada, wrote his memoirs, and is universally recognized, those memoirs, as the inspiration for the novel Uncle Tom's Cabin. So if you have an interest in that part of the local history, it's open periodically there on Old Georgetown Road, and you can still see the outbuilding where, if Henson didn't live there, he certainly hung out in the kitchen. We do know that. So the origin, of course, was farmland. And this whole area was changed by the foresight and determination of one man. And his name was Francis Newlands. And this is one of Harold's postcards, right, Harold? I think it is. And this is a Minnie Brooke postcard. And that is Chevy Chase Circle. And this is Chevy Chase Circle in the very early days when Chevy Chase was first starting. And Francis Newlands was a very foresightful man. Of course, there's a street right here in Chevy Chase called Newlands, and that's from Senator Newlands. He was a senator from Nevada, and also an heir to the Comstock Lode fortune, the silver mining fortune in Nevada. So he had a lot of money, also a lot of political clout. Big surprise, Chevy Chase was founded in part through political influence. Last time that ever happened in Washington, by the way, but this is a fascinating part of this history. Newlands and several of his partners started buying up land from No Gain, Clean Drinking, anonymously. They did it all in secret in the 1890s. Didn't want anybody to know what they were doing because, of course, they didn't want to boost the prices. So they assembled, by most accounts, it's a little imprecise, about 1,700 acres, which is the basis of a company which still exists today, Chevy Chase Land Company. And they bought about 1,700 acres. And their Newland's dream was to create a suburb. And in fact, they barely existed at this point. Chevy Chase was really one of the first planned suburbs in the entire country, let alone in this area. And Newlands had several brilliant insights. First of all, he needed the land. But secondly, he understood that in order to create anything like what's a modern suburb, you needed transportation. And you will see on this picture, going around that circle, a trolley car. And this was the answer. This was the secret sauce that Newlands figured he needed to make Chevy Chase a viable suburb. People had to get downtown. Government was starting to grow. There were a lot of new people moving to this area, but you can't expect them to buy land in Chevy Chase. They couldn't get downtown. So his great project was to build a trolley out Connecticut Avenue. At the time he started this ambitious project, basically the District of Columbia ended at Florida Avenue. It was called Boundary Street. Now that's way downtown. That's just barely north of what's downtown today. On the other side of Florida Avenue, and the reason why it had not, this one of the main reasons why the city had not expanded beyond Boundary Street was the gorge at Rock Creek. And so there was no roads. It was basically a physical barrier. And those bridges over Rock Creek we see today originally were built for the trolleys. And Newlands had this brilliant insight that if he could bridge those two canyons, Rock Creek, and build a bridge for the trolley, he could get people out to Chevy Chase. And that's really how it all started. Now, as I say, it took a lot of money. It also took a lot of political clout because he had to get a lot of permissions. And the legends are that he really used a lot of his political influence to get the permission. But eventually he did. And this was an extraordinary engineering feat. If you think of that bridge, you cross it, you know, almost every day and don't even realize how deep that canyon is and how high, what an engineering project this was in the 1890s. The insight he had was that people would have, if they had a way to get to a place like Chevy Chase, that they wanted to escape the city. The city was a den of iniquity for some people anyway. At the risk of mentioning politics, we know in the last election how often the city was the place where of suspicion and elitism and crime and all sorts of good things and bad things all tied into one. And the suburb was a refuge. And it's very clear that Newlands, this is the marketing strategy behind the creation of Chevy Chase, was to offer people a refuge from the city, whether it was culturally socially, economically. This was the conception behind it. And as you can see, from this slide, there was nothing there. I mean, this is Chevy Chase Circle had cows grazing on it in the early days. Sometimes there was a ball field there as well. And one of the first houses built on Chevy Chase Circle was, in fact, built by Newlands, who used it basically as a marketing tool to attract people out to Chevy Chase. And there was one flaw. He used to invite people out so that they would come to dinner and see the area and maybe get interested in buying, you know, a lot. There's one problem. The trolley stopped running early. And many nights, Newlands found himself with unwanted overnight guests who had missed the last trolley going back to Washington. And in fact, Newlands, despite his marketing genius, gave up on living here. Kept selling lots out here, but he gave up living here, moved back downtown to a house called Woodley House, which is today the home house of Murray School on Cathedral Avenue. So that's where he actually lived, because he was had too many house guests who were marooned by this trolley. Not only did the trolley stop running early, but it was kind of unreliable in many ways. But he persevered. And here's another shot of the trolley on Connecticut Avenue. And this shot is taken right about at the Chevy Chase Club. And at the right, you can't see it terribly well, but that it's still there, that kind of white cupola right there on at the boundary of the Chevy Chase Club. That was the old trolley stop. And it's still there, actually. And this shot is looking south on Connecticut Avenue with the Chevy Chase Club on the right. And but it was not easy, even though it was a very smart idea in many ways, it was not necessarily easy to get people to buy lots out here. And Chevy Chase grew rather slowly, actually. But these trolleys were central. People would commute downtown on them. Kids would go to school on the trolleys, because in the early days of Chevy Chase, they didn't really have their own schools out here. And there was a school, St. Anne's, which a Catholic school over the district line on Connecticut Avenue. Kids would take the trolley down to St. Anne's. And there weren't really many stores out here either. So the trolley performed all sorts of services, including you could place an order with the trolley conductor, and he would go to the grocery store downtown for you and bring your groceries back on the trolley. And this was the lifeline. As I say, they worked pretty well, except when they didn't. It was not highly advanced technologies, because you had these overhead wires kept falling down and breaking. It started to grow. One of the reasons, why don't you go to the next slide, Gail? One of the reasons why they needed the trolley is, look at this. This is Connecticut Avenue. That's a muddy track. Even if you had a car, you couldn't basically drive it on it. That's Connecticut Avenue at about where the 4-H Club is now. Looking south, and as you can see, you've got the trolley track there on the left, but you have the avenue itself isn't even paved. It's just a muddy track. Now, one of the things that Newlands did to try to market land out here in Chevy Chase was build a hotel. It's called the Springs Hotel, and it was built on the site of where the 4-H Club is now, around Thornapple. And it was a total bust. A total bust. It lasted for basically one season. It was a very large building. No one wanted to come out and go to a hotel. I mean, his theory was that people would come out and for the nice fresh air out here, and that they would see these lots and they would get interested in buying them. It was a total bust. And one of the reasons was because right in front of the hotel was this muddy track. It wasn't exactly welcoming. But gradually people started buying land. And one of the institutions that helped develop the modern Chevy Chase was the Chevy Chase Club. Now here's a picture of the original sport at the Chevy Chase Club was not golf. It was fox hunting. And this is a picture from about 1903 of the fox, the hunt at the Chevy Chase Club starting out early one morning. Now, as you all know, on the northern boundary of the Chevy Chase Club today, there's a street called Bradley Lane. And the original farm that forms most of Chevy Chase Club today was owned by a family named Bradley. And in fact, it was a historic farm going back early into the 19th century, but Abraham Bradley started selling it off and sold most of it to the Chevy Chase Club. In the early days of the village developing, they had a hunt there. Now, part of the problem was that the horses and the dogs made a lot of noise. And as they started, it turned out it wasn't very good advertising for selling lots. It was too noisy and didn't smell very good either. So the hunt actually departed from Chevy Chase Club about 1910, 1912, and was replaced by golf. And the first golf course, the first course, Chevy Chase Club, was six holes. And it was on both sides of Connecticut Avenue. And you had to cross Connecticut Avenue to play your six, you play your round of six holes. But of course, there was no traffic on it. You saw it was a muddy track, so there was, it didn't matter. You know, you could just walk across the avenue as long as you didn't get hit by a trolley, and play the course. Obviously, they've developed it somewhat since then. But the Chevy Chase Club originally started as something called the Dunblane Club, which was way downtown around Nebraska Avenue, which also had fox hunting on Nebraska Avenue. Urbanization forced them north. They sort of merged with this club. And so it's very much part of the history of the Chevy Chase Club, but it's been a while since they've had foxes, fox hunting there. And then there are some wonderful stories of families that I've been able to discern, and this is one of my favorites. You all know Cummings Lane, right? Well, Cummings Lane is named for the Cummings family, as are a number of the streets in Chevy Chase are named for early families. Williams Lane is another one. Williams Lane was a farm road. It was the lane came off Connecticut Avenue to the Williams farm, and that's where the name Williams comes from. But this is the Cummings family, and they go back in this area to 1848, and there were two brothers, James and Patrick Cummings, who bought about 100 acres of land. It was really part of Nogain, as well as some other properties, and they became one of the first families of Chevy Chase. And James died fairly young, but his widow built a house called Pleasant Grove. And is it still there? They haven't torn it down yet, have they? But it's in danger, but it's not? No? Good. This house is still standing. It was built in 1897, called Pleasant Grove. Oh, it is gone. You did say, they did tear it down. That's too bad. Well, we have this photograph of it. It was very oddly positioned on Cummings Lane because it didn't front the street. But at one time, this was a working farm into the 1920s. We have photographs of haying, and people would have memoirs. One of the things that Chevy Chase Historical Society has done so well is they have collected a lot of memoirs of folks. And there's a man named George Winchester Stone who, as a boy, spent a lot of time on the Cummings farm and talks about the horses they had and the stables and the livestock that they raised. Now, James' son was a man named Cy Cummings, and he's the guy in the middle. And he was a very noted horseman. And in fact, the cover photo of the book is of the Cummings family. And they, even though the Chevy Chase Club no longer had foxhounds, they did. well into their 20s. They had their own stables, they had their own kennels, and they had, I have several photos in the book of them riding through their land on their own horses, and of course this is the son on his pony right in front of Pleasant Grove. And they were a very important family, and still are. There are still people named Cummings who live on Cummings Lane. So the history of this area, these names, are still very vibrant. There weren't many, why don't you go to the next one, there weren't many businesses. One of the animating spirit of Newlands and the whole plan was to really have the core of Chevy Chase to be a commercial-free zone. Didn't want any shops, didn't want businesses. This is part of the planning ethic, that you separate living quarters and houses and neighborhoods from commercial businesses. However, a couple of people sold their land to the Chevy Chase Land Company. And one of them was the Sonnemann family. They were German immigrants. So because they never sold their land to the Chevy Chase Land Company, they were not bound by the rules that barred commercial enterprises. So Brookville Road was this isolated example of where commerce was still possible. And on the corner, you can see on this this wonderful photograph, it says Sonnemann Brothers, Sonnemann and Son, I guess, Chevy Chase Market. And that was at the corner of Brookville Road and Quincy. There was a market there, and this, and they, of course, had this wagon, and they would serve the needs of some of the Chevy Chase residents in the early days. But the only reason they were able to do this is because of they escaped the tentacles of Newlands and never sold him their property, so they couldn't bar him from opening a grocery store. As this community grew, there were some very vibrant community institutions. You know, here I'm looking at this wonderful room full of people who care about this community. Well, you are following in a tradition that's more than 100 years old. You're following in a tradition that's more than 100 years old of civic loyalty and involvement, often involving lectures and learning and books. It's been, from the very beginning, a central part of the spirit and the history of Chevy Chase. The very earliest settlers here came together in a variety of institutions, and here's one of them. This is what's called the reading class. These were women who gathered weekly, and they would read books and talk about them. And you can see this photograph is 1905, am I correct, Gail? And many of the first families of Chevy Chase are represented in this photograph. The Tucker family, the Stevens family, and many of the first families came together. And as I say, you know, here we are, 110, 111 years later, following in the footsteps of these women who pioneered this civic spirit of learning and books and lectures. And in fact, we have an interesting story from the Washington Post, written I think in 1903, talking about the first library built in Chevy Chase. And they were very proud of the fact that there were 1,000 books in this library. And this reading class would often meet in the library. This was part of a very vibrant community life in the early days. And there was another organization that would meet and would show travelogues. You know, people who traveled would come and show photographs and give lectures about the places they had traveled. So this is very much part of the original spirit of this community. This is the first graduating class of Chevy Chase High School, 1913. There are 8 graduates, by my count. Interestingly, this is before the formation of BCC. Chevy Chase actually had its own high school, briefly. It was always a small school. It was located where Chevy Chase Elementary, Rosemary Street, is now. And that's where the first high school was. And there are, as the community started to grow, there were more and more institutions like this, high school, like the Reading Club, and many others. And again, they're the first families. Many of these photographs come from two families, the Stevens family and the Tucker family. And if you ever go to the website, at Chevy Chase website, one of the good ways to search their database is to put in the names of those two families, because they've been extraordinarily generous in donating a lot of the best photographs we have from this era. So there was a Chevy Chase High School before there was a BCC. This is the next picture. Is of I love this picture. This is the Tucker family. There was a man named Charles Tucker, who was there were two families. The Stevens lived on East Lenox, and the Tuckers lived on West Lenox. And both of them, both families, had men who were very avid amateur photographers. And so Charles Tucker took many wonderful photographs. This is from 1902, of his daughter, Helen, with a woman who we believe to be Alice Clador. She was known as Ottie. And this is one of the rare photographs that includes an African-American that we have from this era. Now, you're really talking about, 40 years removed from the end of the Civil War. And what happened is that many of the slaves who did work the farms in this area after the Civil War then went to work as servants and household employees, farm employees of the families on the property where they once were slaves. And we don't know a lot about Ottie Alice Clador, but it's a good guess that her family was enslaved in this area, and she stayed on and worked for the Tucker family. I have several photos in the book of several people who we know for a fact were descendants of slave families who lived right here in Chevy Chase in this period, in the early... So this picture was taken, the Tucker family lived at 10 West Lenox, obviously a house that's still there. Interesting footnote about the Tucker family, Charles Tucker and his wife were both killed in 1922. It was a famous cave-in of a theater, the Knickerbocker Theater downtown. It had been snowing for 2 days, and the weight of the snow on the roof of the theater caved it in. And there were many casualties, including the man who took this photograph and his wife, who were the parents of this young child in 1902. Here's another. This is one of my favorite photographs in the whole book. This is the family on East Lenox. This is the Stevens family. Somehow he got the six kids to pose on the roof of the house. Now, I keep looking at this photograph and thinking at least one mother is on the ground screaming up and said, "Get those children off that goddamn roof," because this is not exactly a safe idea. But I love the photograph because of the faces. There are just these wonderful expressions on... in fact, this is the photo I wanted on the cover of the book. The publishers had another idea. But I love it because it has such wonderful individual expressions. And several of these kids are from the Stevens family, and some of their pals from the neighborhood. And the Stevens lived in Chevy Chase for many generations. And they were notable for many things, including they were always the core of the Chevy Chase sports teams. There was an early baseball field built in the back of their house on Thornapple Street. They moved from East Lenox to Thornapple Street. They had a baseball field right there on Thornapple. And one of the Stevens boys actually made it to the major leagues and played shortstop for the Philadelphia Phillies. So, and there are several wonderful pictures that we've been able to find, often donated by the Stevens family, of baseball and football teams, but there's one football picture, and they've got, you know, these old-fashioned uniforms, and they're these very studly, and there's somebody flying over them. I don't know how they managed to do this picture. Obviously, it was an early version of Photoshop, but many of the these pictures come from the Stevens family, very generous to the Historical Society in donating some of these photos. The next photo is a famous photo in the sense that the Historical Society has used this many times. These are two boys, Albert Alexander, Hank Higgins, around 1920, and clearly they're up to no good. First of all, they're hitching a ride on the back of a car. I mean, this is almost as dangerous as being on the roof, right? But clearly their mothers were not around to stop them. This photo captures sort of the carefree sense of a summer day in Chevy Chase. Notice a couple of things about this photo. The boys have these very traditional flat caps, the newsboy caps. They're wearing knickers and socks. The license plate on this the car is only four digits. This is, I think, Thornapple Street, and you can't even see any houses on it. But this is a wonderful sense of early Chevy Chase and the freedom kids had for hijinks like that. And one of the ways in which Newlands marketed Chevy Chase was through something called Chevy Chase Lake. Now, you all know the sign, right? You know, up there at the around Jonesbridge Road, you see the sign for Chevy Chase Lake, and you've perhaps wondered, where the hell's the lake? In fact, there was a lake there for about 30 years. Hasn't been there in a long time. But the lake, which was originally built as a source of electrical power for the trolleys, that was the original idea, because they dammed up a small stream, created this lake, and then they would harness the flow of the water to create the electricity which ran the trolley lines. But Newlands was a smart guy. He was a good marketer. And so he also created an amusement park out there. Now, this lake was kind of a two-bit lake. I mean, it was kind of marshy and reedy, but people boated on this lake. I don't think they fished in it. If they fished in it, you probably wouldn't eat what you caught, but it was a great getaway for people from the city. And we have these wonderful records, stories in the local newspapers. In the summer, people would come and they would boat and they would dance. One of the most important things, and Harold has some marvelous materials from some of the early programs of the bands that played there, with listing the music that they played. And this is a historic photo, really, taken by a man named Henry Arthur Taft. He was an electrician. He worked for the city government, but he worked at night. And he had these young children, these two girls, and so he had time during the day to go on picnics with them. And one day, in 1905, he came out to Chevy Chase Lake from downtown on the trolley with his girls and his father. And there's a series of photos, priceless photos, of this family at the lake in the early days of Chevy Chase Lake. And one of the things I love about these photos, and what makes them rare, is that even then, in 1905, it was relatively difficult to take candid photographs. Most of the photos you see from that era are all posed, right? People had to stay still. This guy was a very good photographer, a real pioneering photographer. And he was able to capture these candid views of his children. And that's what makes them quite rare. There are relatively few photos from early 20th century that have this quality. I'm very grateful to his family. What did we track down? His great-great-granddaughter, I think, Gail. And she gave us permission to use, there are about five of these Taft family photographs in the book. But this is one of my favorites of these two young girls. So families would come out, they would picnic, they would hike around Chevy Chase Lake. But one of the favorite things, and what really marked the history of Chevy Chase Lake, was the music and the dancing. And this photograph is of a group of young people, men and women, who presumably are out there to dance. We don't have an actual action photograph of them dancing, but it's a pretty good guess. This is one of the things why they came out to Chevy Chase Lake to do. And one of the most amusing things I discovered as I read the history of this lake was how outraged the parents were about the new dances they were doing. The bunny wiggle. I can't even imagine what the bunny wiggle looked like, but it was very popular. There was also a dance called the Chevy Chase Glide, which was very popular. And the parents were outraged. They tried to ban these dances because they were too sexy. We have a wonderful story from the Washington Post, 1912, saying the parents of Chevy Chase were up in arms, is the direct quote, because their kids were doing these salacious dances at Chevy Chase Lake. I have this view that some undiscovered cave in France or Spain, right, and they find even earlier cave writings than we've ever seen before, and we finally decipher them, they're likely to say, what's the younger generation up to? And this was very much part of the history of Chevy Chase Lake, because the kids could escape to the lake and do all of these dances to the music and they had several dance pavilions. There were famous acts that came out here. Kate Smith, some of you know, she still sings the recordings of her, sings the national anthem at Yankee Stadium most nights. She made her professional debut at Chevy Chase Lake. So it was a place that attracted a lot of big bands of the era and a lot of singers and a variety of other acts as well. But the marketing idea behind Chevy Chase Lake was, again, Newlands hoped that people would get on the trolleys, come out to the hotel, come out to the lake, look out the window of the trolley and see all of these nice lots for sale. And it was really a marketing ploy as much as anything. And in fact, there were two other amusement parks in this area built for the same reason. Out Wisconsin Avenue, there was a trolley out Wisconsin Avenue through the middle of Bethesda, just a couple of blocks from here. And in the area that's now known as Sonoma, there was an amusement park there too in Bethesda. That only lasted a season because there was a hurricane in 1897, destroyed the whole thing. But it was kind of the same idea. And of course, Glen Echo, which also drew a great many people from the city on the trolleys. And I have a whole chapter in the book about Glen Echo with a lot of pictures of the folks coming out from the city on the trolleys. But and of course, Glen Echo had dancing as well and music and a swimming pool. But another institution that was very important in early Chevy Chase, many of you don't even know this, but there was a college here. Chevy Chase College and Seminary. And this is a photo from the yearbook of the Chevy Chase College, 1914-1915. And this was sometimes described as an old-fashioned word, finishing school for young women. And this was on the grounds of what's now the 4-H Club. And was originally, as I say, there was the hotel there. And when the hotel went bust, an entrepreneur bought it and started a college. And so for 50 years, there was a college called Chevy Chase College. It lasted from early 20th century into the 50s. And it was entirely for women, attracted women from all over the country. And one of the reasons we know this is because in this era, postcards were very popular. And the girls who came to the school would write postcards home. And the Chevy Chase Historical Society has this wonderful collection of postcards written by these young women back home. And here is one of them. Now, this is the college as it existed for 50 years. And this message, I'll read it to you because I love this message. This is written on the front of the card. In the early days, the post office would not allow you to write messages on the back of postcards because it would disrupt the address. So these girls would write on the front of the cards. And here's a very good example from 1906. Here is school. What do you think of it? We are having a dandy time. That's and there are some wonderful postcards that we've Harold and others have saved and collected with these messages. And we have a bunch of them in the book. But these messages are just very touching. And this could have been written, you know, yesterday by a college freshman writing home. And so this college was a very important part of life in Chevy Chase for 50 years. It basically went out of business in the 50s. And that's when the property then eventually was sold to the 4-H Society. And that's what it is today. But there's another dimension of life in Chevy Chase that most of you, I bet, do not know. This is 1916, and those tents, those military tents, are on the block between Thornapple and Underwood. And in 1916, there was created the National Service School. And this was created, oddly enough, it was all for women, to train as nurses and other services to back up the military effort that was gathering steam, obviously, in 1916, a year before America entered World War I. And those tents were there. Women came from all over the country to train and march. We have some wonderful photographs of them marching. There's another one. This one is of the women in uniform knitting sponges. I didn't know you could knit a sponge. I thought you had to actually fish a sponge, but it turns out you can do that. This is part of stockpiling medical supplies. It was pretty clear by 1916 we were going to be in the war, and there were going to be a lot of casualties. And so these women were their version of making rolling bandages, and this was important work. And when this camp opened in 1916, the speaker, in fact, President Woodrow Wilson came out to see the camp, but the speaker at the opening of this camp in Chevy Chase was the Assistant Secretary of the Navy, Franklin Delano Roosevelt. And he came out and made the speech at the opening of this camp, and his topic was military preparedness. When you think about how many times President Roosevelt made speeches on military preparedness over the next 30 or 40 years, but one of his first speeches was out here in Chevy Chase to this encampment at the National Service School, right there on between Underwood and Thornapple. This book comes more into the modern time, but the earlier days are really what I got so engaged in. And of course, 100 years after since that encampment on Thornapple Street, there have been a lot of changes. One of the best changes has been the removal of the ethnic and racial codes. We have to be honest about the history of Chevy Chase. Newlands was a racist, and that's pretty well documented. In fact, some of you know there's a controversy over whether the fountain in Chevy Chase Circle should continue to bear his name. But he, in the early days, the land deeds were very restricted. There was an ad in 1916 which explicitly said that this was a community that would keep out undesirable elements. It's part of the history, we can't deny it. But by World War II, with the enormous influx of new families and new workers to the area, those codes really started to lose their power, In 1948, the Supreme Court ruled them unconstitutional. So it's been a long time. That is part of the early history of this area, fortunately one that is now changed. Obviously, another change is we don't have trolleys anymore. Maybe we should. I know there are some people who still regret that Chevy Chase is not on the Metro line, probably fewer than there used to be. You know, we don't have those trolleys. Connecticut Avenue is paved through most of its lanes now. And you can drive downtown fairly easily, except, of course, when you hit the traffic. And, of course, those commuters are now, many of them are women. If you look back in the early days, as you saw, it was the women back in the reading circles during the day, and it was the men who were commuting. And now, of course, very, very different. There are so many things that are different, but there are things, the essence has not changed. The essence of this community, a planned community that provided a refuge for families to raise their kids in a safe and protected place, and a community that has always had a wonderful sense of identity, a sense of community spirit, infused by this notion of not just a neighborhood where people took care of each other, but a neighborhood where people learned from each other, and people taught each other, and people shared their books and their travels together. So this wonderful gathering tonight is really very much in a spirit of over 100 years old that Chevy Chase has always embodied. So thank you very much. I'm more than happy to answer a few questions if anybody would like to ask them. Please, go ahead.
I'm interested in, there's a Chevy Chase DC and a Chevy Chase Maryland. How did
that come? The question, for some of you who didn't hear that, the question was, there's a Chevy Chase DC and a Chevy Chase Maryland. By the way, if someone knows the score of the Redskins game, please let me know. actually, the Chevy Chase Land Company did develop some of the land south of the border. In that north that northwest quadrant, but the homes in D.C. tended to be smaller and less expensive, and most of Newland's work was north of the border. But that is why there is a neighborhood called Chevy Chase, which way in the back. Yes, very much so. Bethesda was the question was, do I cover the development of Bethesda? And Bethesda was, in some ways, similar to Chevy Chase and in many ways very different. The similarity was that it basically grew because of the trolley. The history was very different. Bethesda was always a commercial center, always different from Chevy Chase because of Wisconsin Avenue, Rockville Pike. It was the main road going back to pre-Civil War days between Frederick, Maryland, and the district. And so that road was a commercial thoroughfare, you know, for many, you know, many generations. And the first buildings in Chevy Chase were a general store and a toll booth. it was a turnpike, and you actually had to pay money to travel through Bethesda on that road. And one of the first, the first name of Bethesda was actually named for the general store that was there. It was called, I have a map in the book that has this. The first name of Bethesda, when it first incorporated just before the Civil War, was called Darcy's Store. That was the name of the city, or the hamlet. In 1870, we know that there were 20 people living in Bethesda. But once the trolley came out, it started to grow for some of the same reasons. But if you think about the essential characters of these two towns, Chevy Chase was always planned as a residential community. The history of Bethesda has always been infused by its commercial roots. And in fact, some of you might look at one of these big new apartment buildings that's been built right there in the middle of Bethesda, and the name of it is the Darcy. And the reason why it's called the Darcy is the first name of Bethesda was Darcy's Store. It was renamed Bethesda in 1870. As many of you know, Bethesda is a biblical name. And there was a church here named for the biblical pool of Bethesda. And that's where, in 1870, they renamed the city for that church. But since the biblical pool is a pool of, with healing powers, given the fact that National Institutes of Health and Bethesda Naval Hospital both grew up in Bethesda, it was a nice touch that wasn't planned. But the name Bethesda is very much associated with legends of healing. Yeah.
You mentioned very briefly the restrictions in the church. So as I understand it, Newland not only embraced, he was an anti-Semite, and the restrictions included Jews.
That is correct. He didn't like anybody, except people who looked like him and bought lots. You're absolutely right. And that's, and by the way, that was not the only area and neighborhood in this area that had restrictive covenants. Kenwood did too. Many years later, I had a wonderful friend when I worked at the New York Times named William Sapphire. Some of you remember Bill, who was a columnist for the New York Times. And he every year gave a breaking of the fast party at the end of Yom Kippur, in which he invited all of the conservative Republican Jews in Washington. And he lived right in the middle of Kenwood. And he took enormous pleasure in having all of his Jewish friends come to the middle of Kenwood, which they would not have been welcome a generation or two before that. Yeah.
Photographs of buildings that were that are historically preserved in Bethesda. I'm thinking of the Wilson Store.
Yes, community, that's true.
Which the developers of the Apex building
moved. They've moved it once already.
And there's a hearing at the Historic Preservation Commission on Wednesday.
I have a picture of the Wilson Store, one of the first buildings in downtown Bethesda, was this store owned by a family named Wilson, Wilson Lane. Right? So many of the place names around here are named for these old families. And as the member of the audience clearly knows, this store is really the same store that was Community Hardware. And they've moved it once. I have a picture in the book of the store being moved.
I think they just moved it like 500 feet.
Yeah.
Approximately the location.
Right. It's still on Wisconsin Avenue in the commercial strip, but they moved it about 500 feet. There is another historic building in Bethesda, of course, is the bank building on the corner of Old Georgetown Road and Wisconsin Avenue. That was one of the first buildings of any substance built in Bethesda. The man who really was the equivalent in Bethesda of Newlands and Chevy Chase was a man named Tuckerman, Tuckerman Lane. Right? He was an entrepreneur who bought some old farmland in Bethesda and created what's now Edgemoor. And he moved his family there. And I came across this memoir of someone who said that the Tuckermans in the early days of Edgemoor kept horses, same way that the Cummings family did in Chevy Chase. And they would get calls from neighbors saying, "Your damn horses are on my lawn. Come get them." So that's what life was like in early Edgemoor. But Walter Tuckerman, who was the first president of the Bethesda Chevy Chase Chamber of Commerce and also the founder of the bank, what was then the Bank of Bethesda, which, and I have a picture in the book of the building before that very noticeable stone bank that is still there. And it was basically there in Edgemoor at the edge of his property where he developed it. I have many photographs. I have them both. I have many photographs of the Farm Women's Market, which has always been a favorite place of mine. Cokie and I have shopped there over many, many years. One of the first columns I ever did for Bethesda Magazine was about the Farm Women's Market. And one of the interesting things about that market is some of the original, not many, but some of the original families that opened this market in the 30s are still have stands there. If you go into the Farm Women's Market, right to the left, there's a fellow named Ray Wren, R-E-N-N. Some of you know Ray. I go back to his parents ran that stall before him, and they still have a farm in Burtonsville. and he has the best Carolina Gold tomatoes in this entire area. Yeah. Chase? Yeah, you know, Chevy Chase grew. The question was, why are there so many different sections in Martin's Edition and all this? The fact is that this is all different developers developing it at different times. And connecting, the core of Chevy Chase continued to grow as more sections got developed. There was a man named Martin, and I have a picture in the book of his home. I'm trying to remember what street it's on, but it was sort of the first home in what became Martin's Additions. So that's really why it just grew in all of these. And these sections would get connected to Chevy Chase and absorbed in it. So it continued to grow. Way in the back. Yeah, what kind of crops? Well, originally, the great cash crop throughout Maryland was tobacco. Problem with tobacco is it depletes the soil very quickly. It's probably one of the reasons why they called it no-gain farm, because after a while, you couldn't really grow much on it. We do know that eventually, after the Civil War, when it was no longer having slave labor, tobacco is a very kind of labor-intensive crop. And they started putting in other crops that were less labor-intensive. Wheat, for instance, I have a picture in the book of the day they cut the hay in Cummings Farm. So they changed, but the tobacco was the original crop. This is not part of the book, but if those of you interested in the larger history of this area, a lot of the early farmers were Quakers who came down from Pennsylvania and settled Sandy Spring, Brookville, and those areas. And tobacco was always the cash crop because it brought so much more revenue than any other crop. And in the early days on River Road was one of the earliest streets in this whole area. And that's where they brought the tobacco down from the farms in Up County. They would come down River Road to Georgetown, where they would ship it from Georgetown. And one of the oldest buildings in this entire community is Magruder's Blacksmith Shop, which is on the corner. It's just past the Beltway on River Road. And the reason why this was the blacksmith shop was built there was because of the wagons would come down River Road, mainly with tobacco, hauling tobacco. And they would break, and so they had a blacksmith shop there. But one of the things that happened with tobacco, which really rescued the economy, there are tales of fallow farms all through the area because tobacco had depleted the soil so badly. And someone figured out the magic answer. Bird poop. There's a true story. People started importing this extremely rich fertilizer from South America. And that's the very smart Quaker farmers figured this out and replenished and revitalized a lot of these farms in the area that had actually gone fallow. Yeah, John?
Why is there such a very incorporated areas and non-incorporated areas throughout the whole county of Montgomery?
My pal John asked why they're incorporated and unincorporated areas. I don't have a good answer for that, John. Chevy Chase, of course, has always had much more of a civic identity and therefore moved to incorporate and to create civic institutions. Bethesda has always been a spot in the road. There's no Bethesda County Council. There's no government. It's really entirely ruled by the counties, county police, county fire. I just think it's the way the different communities grew up. Maybe someone has a better answer than that, but Bethesda never had the same sense of cohesion and community identity that Chevy Chase has always had. Yeah, Mary?
If you go to the U.S. Geological Survey and put in Bethesda, it gives you coordinates that are on Bethesda Avenue somewhere around where Ural Motor Cars is. Do you have any idea why historically that has been identified as Bethesda?
Well, this is where you talk about Ural Motor Cars. This is one block off Wisconsin Avenue. And that was the lifeblood of this town. It was the avenue. It built up in very classic fashion around this thoroughfare. So the original businesses were merchants and the Wilson family. And there's one family I have in the book that was smart enough to build gas stations. They rented a feed store, an old feed store, the emblematic of the changing nature of Bethesda, right? The feed store got converted into a gas station. And the Amiri family was, and I have a picture in the book. One of the things that many of you don't know about Chevy Chase is there used to be this huge water tower on Rosemary Street. And that was part of the original infrastructure. I have several photos of families sort of posed around the water tower. And in fact, several photos from the water tower, which give you a bird's eye view of the city, which is very rare because there were no airplanes. But some photographers went up to the top of the water tower and looked down. And so they're very rare photos, very useful. But it's really because of the, it's just where the commercial center was, really. And that, if you look at the old maps, I've got a map in the frontispiece of this book. And Darcy's store was right down the block from where Euro Motor Cars is now. So, also, the other thing about Bethesda was it also had an industrial heritage. Some of you remember there was a cement plant in the middle of Bethesda. And that was because there was a spur, a railroad spur that came through Bethesda that was a freight line. And so Bethesda in the early days was quite an industrial center, and that the reason was because the freight line came through, and there were a number of industrial outposts in the middle. But the last one I remember was the cement plant, Mahoney's.
I'm going to cut you off because you got to sign this.
Okay, she's going to cut me off. I'm going to take one more question. Go ahead.
Where does Chevy Chase start and Bethesda end?
Now that is the great mystery.
If Chevy Chase didn't get the subway, he sure does. Do have the subway. It's kind of a private part of it. We live in the town of Somerset, west of Riverdale. We live in the city of Chevy Chase, not Bethesda.
Well, your mayor is over there. Jeffrey is over there. Your mayor of Somerset.
You
ask Jeffrey. Jeffrey probably knows better than I do. It's such a patchwork, you know. I've looked at the maps, and you know the basic rule of thumb is that west of Wisconsin Avenue is Bethesda, and east of Wisconsin Avenue. But it's not; it's jagged, and it goes back and forth. And particularly since Bethesda is not an incorporated area, the boundaries of Bethesda are not even very well defined. You know, and some people will say Rockville is really North Bethesda, and people have these different sliding definitions. But Chevy Chase has a pretty good, well-defined boundary, but a lot of the other areas.
I think mistakes of mind rather than.
Well, and also this goes back to the origins of this area, right? It was all done by real estate developers. So Chevy Chase always was a more desirable address. So any real estate developer who could plausibly describe their building as being in Chevy Chase, they took advantage of it. Thanks very much.
I want to remind you that the book is on sale here, and Steve is going to stay and sign if you would like to get something, a present. And thank you all for coming today.